So Don Sari asked me to talk a little bit about quantum game theory. And quantum game theory is an instance of quantum computation. So I have to tell you just a little bit about quantum computation and quantum information to even talk about quantum game theory. So in classical information theory, a bit can be either 0 or 1, and a mixed state can be some P1 or P0. In quantum information, 0 and 1 can be thought of as the poles of a sphere. And every point in the interior of the sphere is a possible state of a quantum bit. In particular, this is called the Bloch sphere. And a quantum bit can be 0 or 1 or any complex combination, alpha. And so it's also the case that you change the phase on the state for quantum information purposes, it's the same state. And so because of that, you can write the Bloch sphere state in this other format as well. But effectively, a quantum bit can in principle contain an infinite amount of information. You could stick all the information in all the libraries on Earth in a single quantum bit. However, when you go to query it, you'll get a 0 or a 1, and you'll destroy all that information. So it's a little different than classical information. In doing quantum computation, all the computations except one are unitary. And a unitary operator, it's a linear operator, and its adjoint is its inverse. So all quantum computations are effectively reversible, except for one, the measurement. And the unitary operator leaves the state of the wave function. They're always normalized to one, and the unitary operator preserves that. So let's look at a couple quantum operations. The not operation takes the state 0 to 1 and 1 to 0, and any superposition accordingly. And you can represent the state 0 by the vector 1, 0, and the state 1 by the vector 0, 1, and then you can get a matrix representation of the not operator. That's the matrix representation of the not operator. And you can actually show that if you take the state 0 operated by the not, you get the state 1. Pretty straightforward. So it's, and it's a unitary operator. And it's it turns out that there are four very interesting single quantum bit qubit operators called the Pauli gates, after Wolfgang Pauli. The not operator is one of them. The identity operator is another one. That's a completely quantum operator. And it turns out that every single quantum bit gate can be written as some linear combination of these. It's a nice theorem. So once you know these, you basically know everything that you can do in terms of quantum computation to a single bit. Two-qubit systems are more interesting. Here you have now two qubits. You can write them this way, or that way, or that way. And we call it the tensor product. And you can write them in vector form as follows. Now you have a four-dimensional space that you're working on. If I'm going too fast, let me know. It seems pretty straightforward so far. In quantum computation, you have two new computational resources that are not available in classical: superposition and entanglement. They're actually, we first thought these were just weird oddities of quantum mathematics. And it turns out they're much more than that. They're actually computational resources that the universe has made available to us that allow you to do things that you cannot do classically. And so they're not just oddities for philosophers, they're real computing resources. So here's an example of an entangled state. If you measure one of these functions and find out to be, one of the system find out it's zero, then you know the other one's going to be zero, no matter how far apart they are. And this is something that Einstein didn't like. And it's entangled because you can't write it as a product of two states, a complete product of two states. So Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen were the first to sort of point these kinds of things out, and they thought that they had a counterexample to quantum mechanics as a result of it. So now you can do operations on qubits. If you have two qubits in state psi 1 and psi 2, you can do operations, for example, like a knot on the first one and leave the second one alone. So do the identity operator. And if you work it out, it turns out you can write it down as a 4x4 matrix in that format, and it will do the operation that you'll take a knot on the first guy and leave the second guy, the second qubit alone. You can do controlled knots. Controlled knot, if the first bit is a zero, you leave the second bit alone. If the first bit is a one, you flip the second bit. And so you can write down a simple matrix for that as well. And by the way, I haven't proven it, but every matrix I've shown you here is unitary. So they all are legit. The one operation that's not unitary, it's not reversible, is the measurement, von Neumann measurement in particular. So if you have some orthonormal basis B of basis functions phi I, you can write your qubit as in that basis, where these are amplitudes now, not necessarily real numbers. And then the probability that you're going to get the outcome phi sub I when you do a measurement is the square of the amplitude associated with it. This is a very nonlinear process. It's not a linear gate. And with the von Neumann measurement, it turns out you're going to get the same result if you change the phase. Just a little proof that you change the phase of the qubit, you get the same results.
That's unfortunate. There are two meanings of I.
Oh yeah, subscript.
I is being double loaded here. That's right.
That's a thing to watch out when you're programming these things.
Yeah, you don't want to do it in a program. That's for sure. So in quantum computing, you start off typically with a bunch of quantum bits in a state. Usually they start them off in the zero state. And we used to do unitary operators, maybe a one qubit operator, a three qubit operator, and two and so forth. And then at the very end, you do so everything here is reversible until you get to the very end. And then you measure a von Neumann measurement at the very end to see what each qubit is. So you get initial state psi I, you do the unitary operations, you get a final state psi f, and then you measure. And the measurement gates are each of this form. You put in a quantum bit, alpha 0, 0 plus alpha 1, 1. What happens is that you get an answer B, where B is either 0 or 1. So you get an output 0 or 1. And the weird thing about it, this is where it's not reversible, is you then leave the system in the state B. It so-called collapse into the state B. So definitely not reversible. And this is where all the weirdness in quantum mechanics and all the hair pulling is right here, why this happens. Another gate that we'll need to do the quantum game theory is the Hadamard gate. What it does is it takes the state 0 into this superposition, where notice that this is different than your normal linear combination. If it was a linear combination, it'd be 1 over 2 instead of 1 over root 2. And it's 1 over root 2 because we're going to take the amplitude squared to get the probabilities. So this is actually a different beast than linear combination. It's a superposition. Hadamard gate takes state 1 into this state and the matrix for it. It's very simple. Again, that's a unitary operator. So now we can get to game theory. And I just wanted to show you two games, just to give you, like, the idea was just to give you a quick flavor for the games. So one game I'm going to do is, just because it's a simple game, it's called the spin flip game. You have, in this language, it's always Alice and Bob at it. So Alice and Bob. And the game is, Alice is, and they're playing with electrons, I mean. So Alice puts an electron at the start of the game in a spin-up state U. And then Bob gets to act on it. He can do identity operator, leave it alone. He can do the X operator, which is the not operator. So those are the operations he's got in this sort of classical version. We'll do
so
a
this isn't simultaneous play, right?
No, sequential.
Okay, Bob gets to observe what Alice is doing.
No. Alice is going to do what she's going to do. Well, Alice has promised that she's going to put it in spin up. She could cheat, but she's promised to put it in spin up. Alice is not going to see what Bob does. And then Alice gets to move. This is, by the way, you know, obviously this, if you, I means he leaves alone, not means he's changed it to down. Then Alice gets to do it. She gets to do the same set of moves in this game. And then Bob gets to do it again. And Bob is last. No one sees what the other one's done, so you're ignorant. And if it's at the end of the game, then you measure. And if it's up, Alice gets a buck. And Bob loses. And if it's down, Bob gets the buck.
So a classical game theorist could code it as simultaneous play.
Yeah. So you measure the state electron. So this is what Alice might do. Alice only gets one move in the middle of the game, right? Bob gets two moves, so you should read these sequences from right to left. This is Bob does nothing, then Alice does nothing, then Bob does nothing. Here's Bob switches it, Alice does nothing, Bob switches it, and so forth. These are all the possible states of the game. This is what the state of the electron is in each case. You can see at the very end, it's U here, so this is a case where Alice is going to get a buck, right? Here's where she's going to lose, and so forth. So these are the states of the electron. So these are the payoffs to Alice. Now Bob goes quantum. He wants to make some money. Well, it turns out that when you look at the classical game, their expected payout for each of them is zero. So you know, not much fun. So you'd like to see if you can actually do better. So Bob goes quantum, and Alice decides she might as well just have a mixed strategy. She'll do nothing or flip with equal probability. That's not going to affect a classical game. That wouldn't affect her expected payout. Bob, though, has a Hadamard up his sleeve. And there's the Hadamard operator. So Bob plays the Hadamard. Now what the Hadamard is going to do, if the spin is up, then it puts the system into this neat superposition state. The electron is now, so by Bob doing this, he's actually manipulated electrons, so it's not up or down, it's in a superposition of up and down. Then Alice plays, and she plays the classical mixed strategy. And it leaves this thing unchanged. And then Bob plays the Hadamard again. He plays the same trick twice. And so what happens is he plays the But he's now, this was the state he had before, so now we're going to operate on, with the Hadamard again, and it, you do the computation, you get U. It ends up up. And that means that Bob always wins. So he's not cheating. He just has access to a strategy that the classical person doesn't have. And so he can set it up so that even though he doesn't know what Alice does on any given trial, he will always win. So here's a case where if you have quantum moves, you can beat the classical player. Now for, yes? Well, it's not that they're in a quantum world, that they're playing with an electron, and Bob can do quantum stuff to the electron. He can do moves. Yeah, it has to be something that you could actually do this to. Yeah, you. I mean, we don't know how to put coffee cups into these superpositions yet. But anything that you could put into a superposition electron, it could be a photon polarization, for example, anything.
This is probably not a good approach to soccer.
Yeah, right. Yes, right, yeah. At least not yet. Although there's new evidence right now that macromolecules can be put into these quantum states. The chlorophyll molecule and the retinal rhodopsin can be in these states, and they're definitely macromolecules. Biology's already figured out how to do this. So now, of course, the one that we're all interested in is prisoner's dilemma. And in the classical prisoner's dilemma, of course, the problem. So you have Alice and Bob. C means cooperate, D means defect. If they both cooperated, does anybody not know the prisoner's dilemma? Everybody knows it, okay, so I won't. So standard thing is if they both cooperate, they could get off with a payoff of 3, but if they both defect, they only get a payoff of 1. And it turns out that this is a Nash equilibrium. You better go there, because if you don't, the other guy can nail you. But if they both cooperated, they could both get a better payout. So that's the standard prisoner's dilemma, that the Nash equilibrium is not Pareto optimal. So the quantum prisoner's dilemma. The bottom line is going to be that you can get rid of the prisoner's dilemma with quantum moves. It disappears. You get the Nash equilibrium being Pareto optimal. That's the bottom line. So, but now you have to use entanglement. So, and this is something that we can discuss. I mean, you know, how realistic is it the warden is going to give them a, you know, the prisoner's dilemma's typically got these two prisoners and they're in jail and putting up lots of rooms. If you try to smuggle a quantum bit into both their cells, the warden might have trouble. We can discuss that, but assume it's a nice warden and he's always stupid and he's letting them have it. So they each have a qubit. And let's call the state 0, a cooperate state, and 1, a defect state. And let's, the initial state of their qubits will be 0, 0, say cooperate, cooperate. And in this game, we're going to assume that there's some unitary operator that's applied. So at the start of the game, is actually some state that's obtained after applying the unitary operator. And then Alice will have a strategy, which will be some unitary operator, U Alice. And Bob will have a strategy, which is some unitary operator for him. Okay. And they'll each act on their own qubit. So Alice and Bob each have a qubit. They're going to act on their own qubit. Alice will do UA on her qubit. Bob will do UB on his qubit. The action on the product, it'll be a tensor product action on the joint. Then at the very end, we'll undo this U thing. We'll invert it. And we'll get some final state. And we'll look at that final state. And then we'll give the payouts accordingly, you know, up and down, as before. So measure and payout, I'm sorry, not up and down, but according to this matrix here. So, so for example, the expected payout to Alice will be you take the final state after you've done all these manipulations, and take the amplitude of that with respect to the 0-0 state, the both cooperate state, which would be this. And Alice's payoff will be 3 if that happens. This is the probability that that happens. This term right here is the probability that Alice will get that payoff 3. She's going to get 0 if this is the outcome, and this is the probability of that outcome, and so forth. So you can actually go through the computation here, and this is the expected payoff. So that's how you're going to get your pay at the end. Okay. So the, I've already said all this. So here's the unitary operator that they're going to use. They're going to do nothing on the first bit, nothing on the second bit, plus I times the not and on the first bit and not on the second bit. Okay? And then you do a superposition of it. This is a pretty tricky move. I mean, I actually don't know how to do it offhand, you know, I can't pull it out of my pocket. But
at this point, how many different options do they have?
There's
only still two things they can do.
Well, this is actually just how the system is prepared just to get the game started, right? So U is something that's done up front. Then Alice and Bob are each in their separate cells going to get to do just one operation. UA for Alice and UB for Bob.
Yeah, it's a unitary operation.
See, they're always unitary.
So it's an infinite number of them.
Okay, so if I wanted to, Bob's menu of choices is more than one.
Yeah, but he's
but
he and Alice want to find a Nash equilibrium that's pre-order optimal, so they're going to be constrained to do an intelligent unitary operator.
No, not what they do. Just what's the cardinality of different things?
Oh, it's infinite. Yeah, well, they could do an infinite number of things. Absolutely. Yeah. Okay. There's an infinite number of things available to them. That continuous infinity, in fact.
Is it one dimensional?
No, it's at least two. Maybe it's at least.
What I'm trying to do is I'm trying to figure out.
Might be three dimensional.
Now that the menu of choices is more than two, as cardinality more than two, could you give me the new payoff matrix, where the number of rows is the cardinality of Alice's different things?
Well, you only get payoff once you measure. Once you measure, you collapse back just into the 2x2 situation of the standard classical.
But let me say it better. The warden comes to Bob and says, Bob, what would you have me do? And the warden separately goes to Alice. In the classical approach, Bob either gets to say C or D.
Right.
The warden offers two pieces of paper and say, give me one back that corresponds to what you want to do. In this approach, how many pieces of paper does the warden have to offer Bob?
Well, he's only going to offer him a single piece of paper, and Bob's going to just do a single operation. I'm going to show you the operation.
Then why does he have to ask Bob anything?
No, there's an infinite number.
Okay, so it's an infinite, that's
it's an uncountably infinite number.
Okay.
Yeah, it's actually a continuum, that's right. Yeah. There's a continuum of options, right.
Then I could, couldn't you represent what's done at the end of the day as a function of the product of these two continuum spaces?
Yeah, I suppose you could compute the expected utility for all these combinations.
Yeah, I mean, it'd be basically a payoff function rather than a matrix.
Sure, you could do that. Yeah, I just wanted to show you that there was a way that Bob and Alice could beat the system.
No, I'm just talking about different representations.
Yeah.
No, it's a new game.
Right. Right.
So if I gave a classical game theorist that function and never told him where I got it, just here's a game. Each player has a continuum, a very large number of actions.
The payoffs are just as we were showing earlier in terms of the measurement.
Yeah, I'm not sure that.
Well, the thing is that you can't. If you don't have a quantum computer, they don't have these options. They don't exist. They only exist at a quantum computer.
Well, that's fine, but how many different alternative instructions could they give that quantum computer?
Yeah, uncountably.
Okay, but call that their sample. Call that their
strategy
their space. Strategy space.
Yeah.
And then it's no longer, it's no longer C comma D. Then do this. I'm just saying, could I represent it as a classical game with two really big strategy spaces? It's still each pair of strategies represents. I'm just saying, could you define that mapping?
I guess you could. Yeah. I guess the classical person, in some sense, has an infinite number of strategies too, because any linear combination is so he has an infinite, you know, continuous infinite strategy space as well. It's just that the quantum guy has in his pocket strategies the other guy can't even conceive of.
So that's fine.
And that's why he's going to win.
All I'm saying is that's fine. It's just can you index and write the payoff as the product of those two indexed spaces?
Yeah.
Okay. So my question is, say you did that.
Right.
It's a big matrix.
It's uncountable.
It's continual. It's continual. It's a function of two indexes.
Right.
So my question is, take that function, hand it to a classical game theorist.
Uh-huh.
Never tell them how it was constructed from a 2x2 prisoner's dilemma. Uh-huh. Just say, here's two index spaces.
Uh-huh.
Take it. I'm hoping the answer, I think the answer is yes. Take it and compute the NAS equilibrium of what I'm handing you and claiming as a classical game.
Uh-huh.
Would they get the same answer as is?
I think so.
Okay. No, I'm hoping you'd say yes.
Yeah. I have to think about it, right.
Up to a NAS equilibrium with these,
yeah. Okay,
I think they
could answer your question in one of the other slides.
Okay, I'm just wondering if that's another way to describe the same game.
Yeah, I think they prove it's a magic, as I recall.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, I mean, in other words, cooperation turns out to be the Nash equilibrium.
Actually, the Nash equilibrium will turn out to be a move that's not available classically.
Right.
I'll show you that in just a second. Okay. Then we can maybe try to address this again.
It's a new classical game. I can think of it as you, besides just probabilistic mixtures, you've added new things which expand strategy.
It's possible. I'd have to think about it.
You've created a new classical game.
I just don't know.
I guess you wouldn't call it classical because you need a quantum computer to play it.
I'm just indexing the strategies.
But the Nash equilibrium concept is the same.
The new game has nothing to do with the original classical game.
Yeah, it's a different game.
I think the question is, there's two elements to game theory. One's a representation of the game, one's a solution to the concept of the game. And you're asking, what is changing here? We need a new method of computing a solution, but can the representation be the same? Is that what you're asking? You need to also change the representation.
I'll ask after.
Okay.
Yeah. But
okay. I'm not complaining. I'm just saying, could I think of it that way?
Yeah. Can we go classical somehow on this?
Just represent it that way.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. We'll look at it. See. So. What they're going to do is prepare with the operator U that does this, puts it in that superposition. Now, if they both cooperate, then the result is this state. If Alice defects, you can just compute. These are just computations about what happens if they each cooperate and defect. You can actually just do the unitary operations, and so it turns out that. These are all the classical prisoner dilemma outcomes. So the quantum prisoner's dilemma gets all of the classical outputs, and each one of these occurs with probability one. So the quantum prisoner's dilemma contains the classical game. But now let's let Bob and Alice have the Hadamard operator. And we'll see if you do all the computations, then you'll see that these are the, in addition to the standard payoffs, you get new expected payoffs for Bob and Alice. And you get a new Nash equilibrium, but it's still not pre-optimal. The Hadamard is now the Nash equilibrium, so it actually beats out the defect. now as the Nash equilibrium. But it's still not Pareto optimal, it's dominated by that. But now if you have a the Z operator, and that was another one of the gates I showed you, we'll go back and look at it. Then it turns out that with that, you get that the Z operator, which is a quantum operator, is a Nash equilibrium and it's Pareto optimal. It's not dominated by that. And so you actually have resolved the prisoner's dilemma game. And so if you can then take this and take it into evolutionary game theory and think of the first two moves as just classical. So the I and X operators are just the classical cooperate and defect. And then you can imagine a mutant coming into, a population that has available the Hadamard or Z strategy. And it turns out that so this is the classical one. This is Nash, and it's an evolutionary stable strategy, which means that these are the only options around, only moves around. Then the defect strategy will resist invasion. If you now add a mutant who can do a Hadamard, he now is Nash and evolutionary stable, so he will resist. He will actually dominate. And the H will actually invade X. So here's a case where the classical guy will go extinct. If you have quantum moves, the classical guy on an evolutionary game thing would actually go extinct. And then the mutant Z comes in, and he invades H. And so there are hierarchies of quantum strategies as well. And so this suggests that there could be evolutionary pressures for us to develop quantum strategies in biology. Because if you do have them, and you can play them, you can actually drive to extinction those who only have classical strategies. And there is some recent evidence, again, as I mentioned earlier, that the chlorophyll does quantum computation over 660 femtosecond windows. And the retinol in the rhodopsin does it over a 200 femtosecond window. Both, the chlorophyll has been around for almost 4 billion years. So that the biology figured out quantum game theory 4 billion years ago. And I suspect that the more we look into this, we're going to find quantum computation going all over the place. And that's the actual structure of the macromolecules that gets rid of the decoherence effects and actually implements quantum gates within the actual structure of the atoms in the molecules. So I think that's where we're going to be finding interesting results. And it's a new field. It's less than 10 years old that's discovering this kind of stuff. So so that's just a little top level view of why you might want to do quantum game theory if you're competing against classical.
So if you just continue this about chlorophyll,
yes,
or rhodopsin or something, what would be the analog of this game? Who would be the partner of chlorophyll in the game?
Well, suppose you have as far as I understand, for example, in chlorophyll, the energy efficiency that you get in capturing energy from the photons of light hitting the molecule is higher than you could possibly get by any classical computational strategy. So if you, apparently probably what happened is there may have been some biological organisms around that used only classical means to convert photons into energy, and we don't see them anymore. They're gone.
But it will not be, do I understand correctly that I mean, this can be understood in Darwinist terms, clearly, but not in terms of this prisoner dilemma game, right?
Yeah, we're going to have to think, about just the molecules themselves now. So this is not about, Alice and Bob sharing a bit and so forth. This is about actual molecules instantiating specific quantum gates that are needed to solve certain problems, and at the same time in their structure instantiating what's needed to get rid of decoherence effects, at least over a few hundred femtoseconds, and not long enough for them to do all the parallel searches that quantum searches allows you to do. Yeah, it's more if you look at, you know, like evolutionary game theory now, and you just you look at the payoffs to a system, a biological system that can do a quantum search for photosynthesis versus one that can only do a classical search in photosynthesis, and the one can get far more calories effectively per photon than the other, and then you have them compete against each other. It's going to be pretty clear one's just going to plain dominate the other.
And
yeah, it's not the prisoner's dilemma. It's just a different. Prisoner's dilemma just shows you that you can lose if you're classical. Quantum can wipe you out. And then I'm suggesting that similar analyses will perhaps show that that's why we have photosynthesis, and also that in your very eye are 120 million photoreceptors in each eye that are also doing quantum computations over 200 femtosecond windows, and that's why we might have that. Yeah, you don't have to think about it as game theory. It's probably just, but it is game theory in the sense of evolutionary game theory. That is, you take two different strategies, one that only uses the classical way of converting photons into photoreceptor responses versus the quantum, and see who's more sensitive in the dark and who can, you know, outcompete each other in various situations. It'll still be a game theoretic thing. It won't be the prisoner's dilemma. It'd be a different game. In any case where you have the payoffs being less. I wanted to throw out just one question about the previous talk then. This is more a question on the order effects. I wanted to try to show order effects with just classical probability. So suppose in the game, the discussion we were talking about before, you have the following way of looking at the probabilities that of an individual person on the jury. Suppose that initially they might think the person is innocent. After they hear the defense, say the probability that they still think the person is innocent is 0.8. Probably think that they're guilty is now 0.2. If they first come in with a predilection to that they're guilty, maybe it's now 0.6 versus 0.4. And so model, just using classical probabilities, the effect of the defense on an individual juror. And then have a different matrix, the stochastic matrix, for the effects of the prosecution. Again, you know, if you initially thought it was innocent, now you might be less inclined to think they're innocent after you hear the prosecution and so forth. And it's quite simple to show that DP does not equal PD, and I don't need quantum mechanics at all.
Using a Markov model to produce order effects too.
Absolutely, and so we don't need quantum.
She was talking about classical, she was talking about Bayesian. Now Markov is not Bayesian, but it is classical. Whether it's classical probability theory, but it's not Bayesian computation. It's not a Bayesian computation.
Well, actually, the likelihood functions in Bayes' rule are, in fact, Markov kernels, right? That's and posteriors are Markovian kernels. That's the right way to model them. So all of Bayes is actually Markov kernels.
No, I don't think so. I don't think this example would be. You have a prior times of likelihood. Unless you put order effects in there. If you condition on order, of course you can do it. But this is a Markov model. I agree. So, and that's in a lot of our work we've tried to compare Markov models to the quantum models. So you can get order effects from Markov models.
Sure. Okay. Very good.
For example, in the paper for the question order paper, actually we tried Markov model. It doesn't work. Well, it doesn't predict that.
Okay.
It won't predict. It won't be constrained by the Q2 in any quality.
Okay, cool. That answers my question. Great. So that was all I had. Thanks.
We have 5 more minutes for questions or general questions.
General discussion. Yeah.
General discussion. Yes.
I just wanted to ask a question. By analogy with the experiment on the entangled particles, or just on particles, not necessarily entangled. In other words, instead of asking the question about subjective estimate of probability on the you simply would ask at the end, is the person guilty or not? Yes or no. And you would have, let's say, 300 people with defense prosecution and 300 people with prosecution defense. And then you look simply at objective probability of saying guilty in one group and another group. Would you predict the same things as you are predicting with numerical estimates of probabilities, or is it a completely different thing?
I mean, I have an answer.
I can answer this. The answer is no.
The answer is no.
And Jennifer knows it's no.
Yeah, the answer is no.
And because you are forcing a collapse
right.
that doesn't occur
right.
in your model.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's changing.
So it will be a purely classical situation with no.
Let me suggest that
we make comments and stand up so everyone can hear.
Well, the answer would be that you would have exactly the model that Joyce was saying. You still the order of things. Because hers, they were forced. You were forced to say yes and no to the Then you were forced to say yes and no to the order. You still get order. It's not Jennifer's model.
Wait, is it the response that matters?
What?
Here's
yeah, because in what? It's because in Joyce's study work, they're forced to resolve the uncertainty. But in Jennifer's work, they can report a probability. They're not forced to go out of their uncertainty. They can stay in their indeterminacy.
But if they didn't report anything, if I just did the experiment where I gave them evidence, looked at the end, I would still get an order effect.
Well, she gets an order effect because she prevents the evidence. And that causes. That causes the order effects. It's the conditioning on the evidence that causes it in her case. In Joyce's case, it's the conditioning on the person basically resolves the uncertainty and moves out of the superposition state into a determined state.
But they just print their own answer as the evidence.
Yeah, right, exactly. It's basically said, I made up my mind that Clinton's honest, so that's what I think now, Clinton's honest. It's kind of like they move out of some probability Clinton being honest to Clinton being honest. That's what, how she models it. But Jennifer does.
Well, I think I can cancel my talk tomorrow when I come.
You get to go last.
Yeah, right. There is an issue here, and it involves human faculties that electrons and photons and so on don't have. As far as we know, you look inside an electron, there's nothing. Okay? As far as we know, you look inside a human, you find memory. And that enables you to make the kind of prediction as follows. You ask a person, how confident, and I really don't know the correct order of this, but you ask a person, as you do, how confident of guilt they are, and you can convert that to a probability if you like. But now you say, okay, you're a member of a jury, you have to come to a decision. What is your decision? And they say guilty. Okay? Now, in your model, you have changed a state, which was a superposition, and it's collapsed. It's now guilty. Now you ask them again, how confident are you that you came to the right decision? Your model has to say, I'm 100% confident. I have no doubt anymore. I'm collapsed. I'm in the totally guilty state. There's not a shred of doubt in my mind. That's not how people are.
Oh, yeah, well, okay, Jeff.
First of all, you're leaving out all the dynamics. So in other words, it's really a dynamic. The human brain and the human mind is a dynamic process, right? So you ask somebody, at first they're uncertain. You ask them, is they're guilty or innocent? And now, first of all, they really have to resolve the uncertainty. So when they make their decision, I think the person's guilty. I mean, they really treat that as a piece of evidence that the person's guilty. So it's really an information thing. It's not just like, the way we're thinking about it, it's really an information thing. So anyway, so the person says, I really think they're guilty. So at that moment in time, T0, they think they're guilty. But in quantum models, you always have a unitary operator. And so you're going to start evolving back towards, like a particle. You measure a position of a particle. It doesn't sit there. It's going to be operated on by unitary operator. Okay. It starts spreading out again.
I will buy what you say. When I see the variable t anywhere in theories that you've presented.
No, we have a variable. We have it in.
No, you have a
not
variable.
Not in Jennifer's. Not in Jennifer's.
Yeah.
But we do have it in our other papers.
Let me suggest
we look at
major.
Yeah.
Let's
go.